In this video, we'll look at what the Earth would be like if it was a cube. But we need to start by looking at why Earth isn't currently a cube and why it can't be. So the Earth, like all the other planets in the solar system, is a sphere. And the reason it's this shape is because gravity pulls it into the most compact shape it can get. So gravity wants to pull all the matter towards a common central point. And the shape that can do this most compactly is a sphere. Any other shape would have parts further away, which would essentially be higher, further away from the centre, but a sphere, everything is pulled in as tight as it can be. Now, this isn't the case for smaller bodies in the solar system. You might have seen pictures of asteroids or comets that aren't spherical. Some of them have very irregular shapes indeed. This is because these objects are small, and so that means that their gravitational field is quite weak. And therefore, the material that it's made of can resist the gravitational pull and can still maintain some kind of odd shape. By the time you get to bodies the size of the Earth, though, this just isn't possible. The gravitational field is too strong. Remember also that the Earth is mostly molten, so the crust is solid. The Earth's crust is about 30 miles thick, but below that, it's liquid, and so it is going to get pulled into a sphere by gravity. But even if the Earth wasn't molten in the middle, even if it was solid rock right to the core, it still wouldn't be able to resist gravity. But anyway, let's pretend that that isn't the case. So, let's start with empty space. And now let's add on a cube. Now, the Earth is a sphere 8,000 miles across. For a cube to have the same volume, it would have to be 6,400 miles along each side. The lowest point on this planet would be the centre of each face, which would be 3,200 miles from the middle of the Earth. The highest point would be over 5,500 miles from the centre, which would make them extremely high mountains. The middle of each edge would be a bit like a mountain pass, and it would be about 1,300 miles above the centre of each face. The only level ground on this planet would be in the centre of each face. Because the corners and the edges are higher points, it means that as you move away from the centre, you're going to go uphill. And the further away you get, the steeper the gradient becomes. Okay, now let's add in some oceans. So on Earth, because the Earth is a sphere, gravity also pulls the oceans around the surface in a fairly uniform thickness. They're spread over 70% of the Earth's surface, and as a result, they're relatively thin. The Earth's oceans average about 2 miles deep. On a cube Earth, though, the oceans would be pulled in towards the centre of each face. So you'd have six separate oceans. They'd cover a much smaller area, and as a result, they'd be a lot deeper, very deep, in fact. At the centre of each ocean, we're talking over 70 miles deep. Of course, we now have a sea level to measure mountain heights against. So remember those corners I talked about? They would be over 11 million feet above sea level. Okay, so now let's add some atmosphere. So there's the atmosphere and some clouds. Okay, so like the oceans, the atmosphere would be pulled towards the center of each face. So you'd have six separate pockets of atmosphere. This means that the edges and the corners of the Earth would sit well above the atmosphere. So any mountaineer wanting to climb to the top of one of the corners would need a spacesuit. Because the higher points of the Earth would sit above the atmosphere, they'd end up being heavily cratered like the Moon. The atmosphere protects the Earth from most meteorite impacts, but the higher points on Earth, on a cube Earth, would be sitting out in space, no protection, so they would be heavily cratered. Inside the atmosphere, though, there'd be a lot more protection against these meteor strikes, and so you'd expect to see a lot less cratering. Of course, an atmosphere means that there's also going to be erosion, so you're just not going to see the same level of cratering as you do up on the edges and the corners. Down inside the atmosphere as well, it may well be able to support life. You've got atmosphere, you've got ocean, so it would most likely be an ecosystem, and so you might well, surrounding each ocean, have a circular area of green vegetation. Now, each face would have a separate ecosystem. It has its own ocean and its own atmosphere. So there would, in effect, be six separate biomes. And it's likely that life would have evolved separately within each of these zones. Now, it's possible that very small life forms like algae or bacteria might be able to get transferred from one phase to another. Maybe meteor strikes could hit the surface, throw up rocks. So very primitive life forms might survive the journey through the vacuum of space from one phase onto another. For any bigger life forms, though, this just isn't going to be possible. You know, you've got to come out of the atmosphere into the vacuum of space. Anything that breathes isn't going to make it. So other than primitive life forms, all the higher forms of life will evolve separately on each face. So this means that you could have a situation where on one face of the cube, maybe mammals are the main life form, and on the other face of the cube, who knows, maybe dinosaurs reign supreme. And four other faces, who knows what might have evolved. Now, I'm showing the Earth here in a sort of flat orientation relative to the Sun. So two of the faces will be polar. You'll have a north polar face and a southern polar face. And like the poles on Earth, these will have 6 months day and 6 months night. But unlike the poles on the Earth, there'll be no atmospheric mixing with lower latitudes. So you would expect the climate in these poles to get extremely cold during the winter. The other faces will most likely have a tropical climate. They'll tend to point directly upwards towards the sun, and so they will be the same climate year round, much like the tropics are on a spherical Earth. Okay, now let's switch to a sort of diamond orientation. Here, we no longer have any polar faces, but we do have northern and southern faces, so there would be seasons on this planet. As each pole points away from the sun or towards it, you'd expect the northern or southern faces to get warmer or cooler, a bit like the temperate zones on Earth. Now, it's possible that the climate on Earth may be way too hot anyway. Because the atmosphere is pulled into the centre of each face like the oceans, it's going to be a lot thicker. And a thicker atmosphere means that the temperature is going to rise a lot more as you descend down towards the surface. On Earth, there's a temperature gradient. It might be one temperature at sea level, but as you rise in the atmosphere, of course, the temperature gets colder and colder. The reason for this is that gas, when it's compressed, goes up in temperature, and when gas expands, it cools. So if you imagine air rising up from the surface and expanding, it's going to get colder. It's about 2 degrees Celsius per 1,000 feet. It's the reason why high mountain tops have snow all year round, even in the tropics. Now, this effect is going to be a lot more extreme on a cube Earth because it has a much thicker atmosphere. So it's possible that down at sea level, the temperature might be way over 100 Celsius, possibly too hot for life to exist. It could be that only on the higher slopes of each face of the cube, maybe only there life would be possible, and it's just too hot below. And also, here I'm showing liquid oceans with a clear atmosphere above. But it's possible that the temperature and the pressure would be so great that the water would exist in what's called a supercritical state. It's a kind of neither gas nor liquid, way too hot for any life and possibly completely opaque. So the current way that the Earth is, with a spherical globe, spherical oceans evenly spread around, and of course an atmosphere evenly spread around all over the Earth, is far and away the best. It gives us the greatest available area for life forms, for evolution to happen. It also means that the whole of the Earth's ecosphere is all connected as one. So it gives evolution a much better chance. So although a cubic Earth might be interesting to talk about, we're much better off living on this Earth. Okay, I'll see you in the next video.